old were you when you came out to your parents? One of the lucky ones whose parents love you anyway, and they march beside you in the gay pride march? Do your relatives invite you and your lover to weddings and bar mitzvahs and kvel as you dance cheek to cheek? Mine don't, and they get none of the joy of seeing their baby on television. Good evening, I'm Marcia Pally, and this is Our Time. Tonight we're wondering if we refrain from coming out to our parents because we think it'll kill them, because we'll lose their love, or they'll disinherit us. Shrink for the latest in deprogramming.
Not only that, but what should you do if you do decide to come out to your parents and they threaten to shoot themselves? Do you tell them that you were only kidding and hope that they buy that routine? Do you move to San Francisco and change your name, or do you join the city ballet and get married? Actually, the question is their happiness or should their happiness depend on your unhappiness? Tonight on Our Time, we're going to talk to Amy Ashworth, one of the directors of in New York, and to Jay Blotcher, who is a young man who came out to his parents years ago and has never regretted it. And we're going to be talking about family, when you should, how you should, if you should. I'm Vito Russo. Also tonight, later on, Renee McCoy, an Our Time host, is going to be talking with Mabel Hampton, our very special guest, who is 80 years old, a black lesbian who's going to talk about being gay in Harlem in the 1930s, at a time when the word wasn't even mentioned, but people knew we were there.
Well, I'm talking to writer Jewelle Gomez about what might be considered a provocative genre of literature, lesbian vampire stories. After that, Tom Steele, whose humor spares no one, will perform a spoof on Parents of Gays. Stick around. And right now, we'll take a look at our question of the week.
Do you think that they're gay? Do they have a right to be afraid of that?
Yeah, they do. You don't have to upset them unwarrantedly.
You think that's the reason, they just don't want to accept it.
Mm-hmm.
I think most people are petrified telling their immediate family, because after all, I mean, if they're not accepted by their immediate family, who will accept them? I think that's basically the hardest. I mean, I know for myself personally, it was the hardest. And I found out that they accepted it, you know. I mean, they have no other choice, right?
Hi, we're back in the studio. You know, gay teenagers have more problems than just coming out to their parents. Do you remember the high school dance where the boys and the girls danced together and you were on the edge of adolescence wondering why something wasn't quite right, if something wasn't quite right? We have a film clip from about one such experience from Jan Oxen's comedy in Six Unnatural Acts.
Angel baby.
I went to a parents of gays meeting in New York to do a program that I was presenting, and I was fascinated because there was a young couple from Jersey with their 14-year-old son, and it was their first parents of gays meeting, and they were asked in the beginning to tell why they had attended this meeting for the first time. And so the father said that his son had asked a few days before, could they go for a walk, because he had something to tell him. And during the time they were walking around the block, he announced to him that he was gay. And the reason why they were there with their 14-year-old son at Parents of Gays was because he was in high school, and he was too young to go to the Princeton dances, the gay dances at Princeton, and he didn't drive. And they wanted to know where their son could meet gay people his own age. And I thought, my God, 10 years ago they would have dragged him off to some psychiatrist or dragged some priest. And here now, things have changed so much that here's a couple of people bringing their son to a meeting to learn how their son could meet gay people his own age because he doesn't drive yet. And it was such a revelation to me that I realized that there was a new generation of parents to go along with the generation of lesbians and gay men that was also new, and how important it was for parents of gays to be there so that people could come and see one another and talk about what they could do, not only to help their children, but to help themselves. And so I'd like to welcome tonight my guests, Amy Ashworth, who is with the Parents of Gays New York, and also Jay Blotcher, who came out to his parents just about 2 years ago. He was a student at Syracuse University, and he's a writer now for the New York Native, and he has never looked back since he made that coming out speech to his mother. And I'd like to start with you, Jay, okay? And ask you first, what made you decide to come out to your mother? What prompted the decision? Were you scared?
Well, I think it was an overwhelming sense of independence. I had just returned from Europe, traveling around for a summer after going to school in London. And I was on my own, and I had time, you know, having a backpack slung over my shoulder and wandering all across Europe, having time to think about who I was by myself. And when I came home, I found myself in the interesting position of living at home again for the summer, something I hadn't done for about 2 years. And I think my mother was a little more aware of who I was as a person, as was I. And at the end of the summer, she asked me if I were gay, and I decided that it was time to tell her.
What was her reaction?
She was surprised. She felt like she had opened some sort of box that she hadn't expected to be there. And the conversation ended rather quickly after that first admission.
Do you think you have a better relationship with her now?
I think I feel closer to her in a way, but the word gay seems to be taboo still, and we don't mention it. Although it's rather difficult now because my career involves my gay life.
Amy, how did you, I know your son Tucker came out to you, how long ago now is that?
8 years ago.
8 years ago, and did he tell you or did you ask him?
No, he told Dick and me together. Uh-huh. And I always marvel at the fact how well he did it, because he was sure of himself, and he liked himself, he was himself. And Dick was very casual in his answer, are you sure, and should you talk to anybody? Now we know you don't ask that. But for me it was harder, but I felt I didn't want to ask too much to Tucker. I really wanted a support group, eventually,
yeah. You know. Yeah. How did you come to Parents of Gays?
Well, Tucker was the one who mentioned it. In the beginning, every mother feels guilty. You feel guilty when your child falls off the bicycle, so with this I felt guilty too. And then all I asked him was, do you resent me? Because I thought I was the cause of all of it. And both Dick and Tucker laughed and said, you don't have all that power. So we saw Tucker later that week, and I realized he really was the same person. But I had questions, and he sent us to Parents of Gays.
Uh-huh. When you got involved with Parents of Gays, did it seem to you that a lot of the parents who were coming to the meetings were blaming themselves for their children being gay?
Yes. I think parents feel guilt. Some parents feel anger in the beginning, and then they're very confused and have so many questions, you know. Grandchildren, maybe, what did we do wrong? How will we tell the neighbors? Things like that.
Do you think part of it is that a lot of gay people, a lot of parents of gay people feel that they
that they have to live through their children, that they that they're, you know, their only contact with life is through their children, and that they expect so much.
It depends from which culture you come. But I think many people want to live through their children. And that's the case, for example, with grandchildren. And I think nobody can live through their children, and it has nothing to do actually with being gay, because if you have great hopes for your son to be a lawyer and he decides, well, he wants to be a gardener, it's the same.
Same disappointment. Yeah.
And what I think, if when you've raised children, if you then can find a niche in your own life, what you like to do, and sad to say, society hasn't done that yet. You're supposed to be a grandmother and supposed to help raise the grandchildren.
Right.
But many people I know love the work they are doing now and don't miss that stage.
Jay, do you think your mother, for instance, is the kind of a person who might come to parents of gays if she was having trouble accepting it? Or would she have a reason why she wouldn't want to do that, for instance?
I don't think she's prepared right now, or maybe she is because she can't face it. And we've never quite talked about it after that first admission. And this past summer, when I was preparing to come to New York to start my career, I reminded her what I would be doing, that I would become a gay journalist, that is, writing for a gay newspaper. And she seemed to accept the fact that I could turn a lifestyle into a career. That somewhat comforted her. But other than that, she didn't want to know. I would hope that if there was something bothering her about my being gay, that parents of gays could help her.
What about your father?
My father doesn't know.
Do you think you'll ever get around to that?
I think it would be more a preparation of myself. I think any time I hit him with it, he might be ready.
You mean because of your mother already knowing? And
right.
Yeah. Amy, do you give advice to gay people about when to tell their parents, or perhaps there's a time when they really shouldn't tell their parents?
Yeah,
you know?
I agree. I think it's up to the gay person themselves when he or she feels comfortable with it.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe the best thing is when you don't any longer live at home. And then when you feel sure about yourself, I feel it's very important to go to your parents and say, you know, and say that you're happy about who you are. Also give your parents a time, you know, to digest it. You can't be impatient. Took you time, and the parents need the time. And come prepared with all the questions they will ask. And I think it's very important to mention parents of gays, and come with a book, Now That You Know, by Betty Fairchild.
Oh yeah, it's an excellent book.
That's excellent. And be prepared that they ask questions. And if they don't ask questions, which I think sometimes is the case and it gets shoved under the rug, I would bring it up again.
Uh-huh.
I would try not to lose my temper. That's very important. And I would say to my parents, I spent my whole life with you. I've listened to you. Please give me one afternoon of your attention. And then maybe take them out for lunch and then go to parents of gays, to a meeting, you know, and maybe call one of us beforehand. So we are prepared. And I really have, at the last meeting, after those terrible hearings, we had 55 people who came, who cried, who felt very upset, and they left and they had a smile and they said, you know, see you next month.
Yeah.
I believe so much in support groups.
Yeah, because it helps them to know that there are other parents who are going through the same things that
That's
they are
right.
going through, and to help them through it.
Yeah.
How many chapters of Parents of Gays are there now?
Well, it's difficult to say. We form Parents Flags, and the headquarters are in Los Angeles.
Flags is parents.
Parents and friends of lesbians and gays. And that's, we have our headquarters in Los Angeles.
Uh-huh.
Last year we had our first convention. This year we have the convention in New York over Columbus Day. And from one group, it's, you know, Jean Manfred really started, we have now, it's hard to say, 60 groups maybe all over the country.
All over the country.
Yeah, and our groups in Canada, in Holland, in England, in Israel, they hope to form one.
Really?
So it's really spreading. Yeah.
That's extraordinary. What goes on at a typical meeting?
Well, the parents come, and many times the parents who have just heard it are upset, don't want to talk too much. But then, you know, somebody else will bring it up. And then you realize everybody feels guilty, everybody's worried about more or less the same things. I thought I was the only mother, and in the suburbs, you never talk about sex, let alone. So for me, it was a revelation that 10% of the population was, is, will be gay.
Yeah.
And so they see different mothers, some very submissive, some a little bossy, but they see the happy mixture and realize what society has been telling us just isn't so. And then we have a speaker. I must say I learned the most from the speakers. And if we don't have a speaker, we break up in small groups. And last month, for example, parents of lesbians wanted to talk about that and did so, and it's very good.
Jay, do you feel that coming out to your parents was maybe the most difficult thing you had to do? I mean, coming out to your mother? Or see, most people, I feel, will be public. Like, for instance, you write for a gay newspaper. Other people will find other ways to be public and gay, and they'll draw the line when it comes to their parents because I think they feel that they want to protect them from this or they don't want to hurt them. And did you feel that once you did that, I mean, once your mother knew that you were gay, a certain sense of, like, that now you had done the most extreme thing that you could possibly do? Or?
Parents nachas, which is pride. And you're told that, you know, since you're that small. And that was something I grew up with, a very strong understanding that everything I had to do would make my parents proud. And when I was growing up, even though I was rambunctious at times, I knew that I had to find some way to redeem myself in their eyes. And when I realized that I was gay, I'd been fed all the talk about it being wrong, so I felt that I was not only shaming myself, but shaming my parents. It took a long time for me to come to terms with that, to the point that I was proud of who I am. And so it was a point in my life where I had confident that I was to tell my mother.
Mm-hmm. What advice would you give, Amy, to parents who might be watching the show? Maybe they've so far been upset and they haven't reached to other people yet. It's okay.
I'm sorry about my cold. What was the biggest revelation to me was your son or your daughter is the same person. Mm-hmm. They have not changed. And it is you who need education. And the best way to do it is really come to parents of gays meetings. And what I found, that I look back at our last Christmas, where our oldest and youngest son came there with their friends, lovers, whatever you say, and what a wonderful sharing it was.
Yeah.
And what I think is, there's so much positive in it. I must say that it is difficult. All of a sudden, everything society told you, you have to reevaluate. But for me, that makes for a much richer, more honest life. And I think to the parents, love your children. They need you more than any other group, because gay people are the only ones who don't have the support of their families behind them.
Right.
And so love your children, listen, and read, and come to our meetings.
Very good. We went out on the streets during the week with our cameras, and we've been asking people on the streets, do you think that there's a very good reason why most gay people choose not to come out to their parents? So just in a second, we're going to look at some more answers from the streets. Do you think that there's a very good reason why most people don't come out to their parents? Is there tremendous amount of fear
on
the part?
I keep on saying you have to have a good relationship with your family. And sad to say, that's often not true.
But
if you have that, then I think be prepared, read. The National Gay Task Force has a wonderful booklet. And, you know, read and tell your parents.
So part of the problem is that from the very beginning, gay or not gay, that a lot of people simply don't have a very good relationship with their parents. And so that compounds the problem. It's not necessarily only just being gay. It's that they need to have some sort of communication.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
But the reason I'm so optimistic is because I see the changes at the parents' meetings.
Yeah, it's nice when you sit there and you see.
We opened a group in Westchester, 45 people.
You know,
and people are learning, people are helping. That's wonderful. In Long Island, a wonderful group.
In Huntington.
They have 50 in Huntington.
Okay, well, I'm really heartened by all this information, too. And I'd like you to stay tuned because we're going to talk a little bit more about children and parents. Also, we're going to introduce you to a doctor who has some startling medical revelations. Also, you'll hear a lesbian vampire story. You'll meet Tom Steele doing his own versions of A Little Parents of Gay Meeting, Mabel Hampton, and much more. So please stay with us. And now here's the answers to our question of the week.
This portion of our time is brought to you by Christopher Street Magazine.
Do you think that there's a good reason why most gay people don't come out to their parents?
A good reason? No, I think it's just fear.
Well, I'm not sure if the reason is really good, but I think it's just fear because of not being accepted in general. In my case, there were a couple things in my family that were, my parents had a lot to deal with, and I had no real problem with my gayness, but in terms of them, I felt they would worry or be upset, so I didn't want to have to give them another level of things to deal with their parent, with their children. But when I did, it was, they felt that life was a series of choices, and they just wanted me to be happy with my choice and know what I, you know, they felt that they wanted me to know what I was getting into, but at that point I already did, you know.
Do I think there are good reasons?
Yeah, I think that there, for myself, I think there was a good reason why I haven't told my father that I'm gay, which is that I know it's something he would feel guilty about for the rest of his life. So, you know, I think that's probably a real basic reason why a lot of people don't tell their parents why they are.
I think a lot of times, I know with some of the gay people I know, especially the gay men, they're 99% sure their parents know, but as long as nobody talks about it, nobody has to deal with it directly. And given the level of homophobia today, plus the feelings I think a lot of parents have that they have somehow failed, you know, gee, if I'd have played with him more when he was three, you know, it makes it a very difficult and stressful situation. But the rewards for the parents, if they can accept their homosexual children and their lovers the same as they would accept a husband or wife of a heterosexual child, are immeasurable.
I feel that people are basically fearful of what society might think, and also the fact that they would be alienated feelings from that and then cause a lot of isolation and further alienation.
Maybe like if they come out to their friends and if they come out to their parents, and most parents are like really straight-laced, and I think, I mean, parents might like say, well, you're not going to be a part of the family anymore, and most friends are not going to be like be their friends, and which doesn't really mean anything, because if you come out to your friends and they like reject you, it means they weren't really your friends in the first place.
What do you know about vampires? What do you know about lesbian vampires? Traditionally, the lesbian vampire or the vampire-like woman has been used in film and in literature to depict the predatory, clawing woman stalking the earth looking for young, innocent, blonde girls to seduce. Recently, however, the image of the lesbian vampire has taken a different turn in the writings of Jewelle Gomez. Jewelle is an editor of Conditions magazine and a poet with a published collection called The Lipstick Papers. She has contributed both poetry and fiction to a book called The Gap-Toothed Girlfriend's Anthology, published by Third World Feminists. She's taught workshops in creative writing and literary criticism in such places as Rutgers University and Hunter College. Well, enough with this prelude. Let's get right to the heart of the matter. Jewelle.
Gilda is more than alive. The 150 years she carries are flung casually around her shoulders, an intricately knit shawl handed down from previous generations, but distinctly her own. Her legs are smooth and mocha brown, unscarred by the knife-edged years spent on a Mississippi plantation and strengthened by the more recent nights dancing in speakeasies and discos. The dichotomy does not escape Gilda. Her power was forged by deprivation and decadence, and the preternatural endurance that has been thrust upon her unexpectedly. Her grip can bend bone or metal, and when she runs, she is the wind, she is invisible and alone. Tonight, going home to Effie, she walked easily, gazing at the evening skyline. The tree-shrouded park sloped downward from city streets to the sluggish river. The soft sound of the water played in her ears, obscuring the city sound. Ahead of her, through the darkness, Gilda saw a man leaning against the park fence, hidden from the streetlight by the shadows of a thick maple tree weighted with spring leaves. Her body tensed, but she felt no fear. He was in his 20s, strongly built, and obviously up to no good. But he was only a man, while she, well, she knew the ropes. What she did feel was anger, something she'd only recently learned could be hers. Her mother, Fulani features hemmed into a placid gaze, had not been allowed that luxury. She had been a slave, admonished to be grateful, not angry. As a child, Gilda had never understood. The master who owned all and was responsible for everyone never showed anger. His wife, whom he pampered and worshipped oppressively, was angry all of the time, as was the overseer who regularly vented his wrath on black flesh. But they were not thought to have anger, any more than a mule or a tree cut down for kindling. The young man stood under the maple, his intentions leering out from behind an empty grin. As she walked past, he spoke low, almost directly into her ear. "Hey, Mama, don't walk so fast." Gilda continued on, hoping he would take his loss and shut up. He didn't. "Oh, Mama, come on, be nice to me." The anger speared her, leaving a metallic taste in her mouth. Where were the words for what she felt? She stopped and turned to him, smiling as she remembered the retort of an irate Chicago waitress in 1948. "I am not your mama. If I were, I would have drowned you at birth." She walked on. He caught up again. "Why you bitches so hard? Come on, sister, give me a break." She walked on. "Come on, little girl, let me see that smile again." With that, he seized her arm in what he thought was a vice-like grip. She shook free easily, leaving him off balance. Without another word, he snatched at her close-cropped hair, hoping to pull her into the shadow. Rage replaced the smile on Gilda's face, and a low moan sounded in the back of her throat. She could almost see her slim fingers clenched around his neck, snapping the connection to his spine. She replaced that vision with the memory of a hot night in Florida in 1950. She'd been sitting in an after-hour club watching the fighter show how he'd whipped a Tampa boy who'd said boxing was just a coon show. Gilda smiled again as she raised her fist and it smashed into the man's jaw. He fell unconscious to the cracked pavement, half sprawled on the thin city grass. Gilda lifted him from the street so that he sat against the tree, then knelt low, hiding them from the traffic. She smoothly sliced the flesh behind his ear with her fingernail and took the blood swiftly, enjoying the warmth as it washed over her. She then held her hand to seal the wound and felt the man's faint but steady pulse. As she rose to leave, Gilda was glad she had such a good memory. She said aloud, "Yeah, Joe Lewis was a heck of a fighter." She turned quickly, disappearing inside the wind blowing off the river.
That's one hell of a story. Okay. What's the most important thing about your writing as a whole?
Creating a mythology. A positive mythology for women in general and for black lesbians in particular to have something to grow up on and to look to.
A mythology that they haven't had till now or different from?
I think there's a tradition of literary mythology. I mean, John Henry, Captain Ahab, I mean, I can think of all these characters that men grow up with that are bigger than life. And women need that and don't have it because we want to grow up to be our own heroes, you know.
So are you creating heroes for us?
I hope so. It's hard to find a fantasy figure that people can relate to on a human level, and that's what I try to do. I mean, a story about a vampire who gets mugged is...
Even vampires get mugged.
Yeah.
Do you think you'll be able to have a sufficient impact, given you're dealing with poetry and fiction, rather than TV or film, where most of the mythology and heroes are being created today?
Well, I really do think that people always do read. No matter what, you know, how popular television is, people will read. If you look at shows that come on, you know, like Brideshead Revisited, how many copies of the book were sold after that?
Could you briefly tell us how you got involved with writing vampire imagery and what are its how is it useful to you to create this mythology for women?
Well, I got involved with, I've always been interested in fantasy fiction and science fiction, and toyed with the idea of doing a vampire story the last time I read Dracula, and I decided I could use it, but I never, you know, really got around to it. And then I was involved in a highly unrequited love affair and wanted to translate that grand passion to something and get it, you know, out that way. And so I decided, okay, this is a great idea, so I'll use, you know, a larger-than-life motif, so I'll use a vampire.
What specifically about a vampire, though?
Well, the qualities I see in vampires are they're the embodiment of loneliness. They are characters who are eternally left alone by their friends and family who die. They have to create a new community for themselves and sustain themselves on their own love.
Let me ask you, if all your lesbian vampires are, or if all the stories are written with the intention of women taking power in situations where men have traditionally wrested it from women,
I'd say that's probably a topic that I'm a little obsessed with.
Just a little obsessed with. Yeah.
So all of the stories that I write, vampire and non-vampire, are written from that perspective and that sensibility. Sure. Yeah. Sure.
Does that contribute to the hero mythology?
Yeah. I don't think I'm trying to create a situation where we can only have good guys. You know, good characters, and they're all going to wear white hats or anything. But that possibility of wresting control for yourself, I think, has to be presented, which often doesn't happen.
Have you ever gotten any criticism from people mm-hmm. who've objected to associating lesbians? I mean, we are trying to promote a wonderful image for ourselves, and vampires, you know, vampires who have not traditionally had such a great image.
Yes, I have. I have had black lesbian feminists complain to me that I really have no right to make that connection, and I think I have every right if that's what I want to do. I mean, I have the power to recreate a myth, and it's shortchanging me to think that I don't have that power. And if our world is going to be big enough, it can fit in, you know, vampires as well as anybody else.
Do you think that the critics don't understand that you're in fact recreating a lesbian vampire in your own image or for other purposes than it's been traditionally used?
Probably not. And the first thing is the fear. And if you're not initially involved or interested in fantasy fiction, you can't think why anybody would want to be bothered. But I like popular literature. My writing is popular. It's not weighty tomes to be taken, you know, to a dusty library. And my poetry and my fiction are both written, you know, in a way that I feel the message is not hanging over your shoulder. It's for enjoyment, so I can do that. Why not?
Why not? Have you ever gotten a response from straight women or men? Any hostility?
Actually, no. Mostly at readings that I've done, that a few have been present, really get into it. And, you know, I'm assuming that they were straight. I really don't know.
Who are they identifying with when they get into it?
My writing. I just assume that it's the writing that will carry it over. If I can do it well enough, everyone will enjoy it. You know, I mean, when I was growing up, Jack London was my favorite writer. You know, I identified with Seawolf, you know, so if the writing is good enough, people will identify. The straight friends that I have are interested in the process of my writing, so they don't, you know, criticize it one way or the other.
Yeah. Who do you think your audience is with your writing in general and possibly specifically with lesbian vampire stories?
Well, the political situation being what it is today, the majority of people read within their own little box, you know, the things that are supposedly, quote unquote, of interest to them. So I assume that most of the people who read me are black lesbians. I know that when I go to readings, a lot of people who come to hear me are women, black and white, third world women. So I assume that's my biggest audience. You know, I haven't had any men throw anything at me, so I guess they come.
Well, you just take out your fingernail and
yes,
the finger
to dispatch them quickly. But, you know, I assume that people in general are going to want to read the things.
Yeah. Do you hope that people read outside their little boxes? I mean, is this something that's a concern of yours?
I desperately hope so, because, you know, if you can't go as far as to read outside of your box, how are you going to live outside of your box?
How many of us live outside of our boxes?
You know, it's right. The reason for using the mythology one of the nice things about using that mythology is you're touching on a basic human emotion, which is loneliness and a need for family, which stretches across the entire spectrum of humanity.
Yeah, that's true. We have to wrap up, but I also have to say that you touch on a basic need for strength and self-respect and the ability to take care of yourself, and I think that that's also very important. That's something that I certainly get from your stories. Well, thank you, Jewelle, for coming and for reading to us and for feeding our wildest fantasies tonight. We'd like to go back now to the issue of gays and parents, but this time we're going to stick to the less serious side of things. Tom Steele has managed to find some humor to lighten our minds when we think of mom and dad. Let's take a look.
Welcome to the monthly meeting of parents of gays. Mrs. Teenform, please stop crying. You've been crying for 2 years, and it's depressing the dickens out of us. Now, for the first order of business, I'd like to thank Mrs. Cahoots for the refreshments. Those lavender lambda cookies were an inspiration. Mrs. Teenform, did you have one of Mrs. Cahoots' cookies? Well, you see, you'd feel so much better if you did. Well, I see tonight we have such a good-looking crowd. I give you a hand, and we give each other a hand. Isn't that right? Yes. And I see Miss Armstrong is here again tonight. For those of you who are new here this month, Miss Armstrong is neither a parent nor married, but if she were married, and if she were a parent, she'd want to be a parent of a gay. I must say, Miss Armstrong, you look simply divine in your parent of a gay t-shirt. Speaking of t-shirts, I'm sending around a get well card. Mr. McGillicuddy, you know, is in the hospital. He was wearing his parents of a gay t-shirt in a parents of a non-gay neighborhood. Mrs. McGillicuddy says he's doing just fine. He'll have the stitches out tomorrow, but please sign the card as it comes round to you. Mrs. Steenform, please stop crying. You've gotten your little lambda all wet. Now, later this evening, Dr. Shangid Chatterjee is going to discuss a very important problem, especially for those of you who live with a gay of a parent. And that is, what to do if your little Billy or Dixie brings home his or her boyfriend or girlfriend in order to simulate a heterosexual relation. At the back of the auditorium tonight, we have a sign-up sheet for the softball game next week. We're going to be playing the gay atheists. Yes. And I hope that those of you who are parents of gay atheists won't be booing our side. Mrs. Tennyson couldn't be here tonight, so I'm going to read the minutes of last month's meeting. As you recall, we went round in a circle and told what food it was we threw up when little Billy or Dixie told us that he or she was gay. Mrs. Blurt had been eating beef stroganoff. Stop crying, Mrs. Teenform. Mrs. Gigglestorm was actually eating an egg salad sandwich. I had an empty stomach, fortunately, when my little Teddy told me. Unfortunately, you recall, Mr. Pearl had just taken his barium for his annual checkup. What a mess that must have been. Stop crying, Mrs. Teenform. Will somebody please slap Mrs. Teenform? There, now, isn't that better? Now, Mrs. Verdicchio is going to read a poem that she wrote especially for this occasion. Mrs. Verdicchio? Thank you. This poem is called Gay, Gay, Okay, Okay. By Anna Maria Teresa Verdicchio. That's me. I remember the day when my son told me he was a gay. Today I say okay, okay, okay. But I didn't then. My son, he say he liked the boys. I beat him black and blue. I say, you rejected the Virgin Mary. That's not a nice thing to do. I go to the priest in the rectory. I say, my son, he only like guys. The Holy Father, he bring his face real close to me. He said, what color your son are eyes? Poems were made by gals like me. I make you pasta, I buy you toys, and only God can make a tree. So why you make a lover to boys? Bravo, Mrs. Verdicchio. I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm going to sit down tonight and write a letter nominating Mrs. Verdicchio for the O. Henry Poetry Award. Our next speaker is Mr. Beefbottom, and he has a special problem. You see, ever since the day that his son told him that he was gay, he's had the hiccups.
Thank you. I want to tell you, the day that my son flew in from San Francisco to tell the little woman in me that he's a homo, well, it's just been hemorrhoids and hiccups ever since. We love our boy, though. It hasn't been easy. But I just wanted to tell the rest of you, just give it some time. Give it some time. Give it.
Oh, poor Mr. Beefbottom. The doctors have made no progress whatsoever. Well, maybe you should try crying like Mrs. Teenform. In fact, why don't you two sit together? Yes, only don't give Mrs. Teenform the hiccups or her tears will be flying all over the room. Last week, Mrs. Cross had a wonderful suggestion, and I wanted to share it with you. Just little things that you can do around the house to let your son know, especially your son, that you know that he's a gay man and that you're proud of that. Just little things. When you're stacking your magazines on your coffee table, your Cosmopolitan, your Reader's Digest, put a copy of Blue Boy on top. Or Straight to Hell. And don't forget the bathroom. Nothing makes a gay boy happier than a soap on a rope. And you fathers out there can wear chaps just as easily as you can wear Bermuda shorts. And remember what brave Mrs. Hallowell said when her son Atlas said to her, "Mother, I'm an animal." She said, "Atlas, so am I." Now we come to the close of our meeting, that special time when we draw names from a hat to see who's going to get to represent Parents of Gays on the Phil Donahue show. Guess which parent of a gay we're going to sacrifice to the fundamentalists in the Midwest. May I have the hat, please? The Parents of Gays will be represented on the Phil Donahue show by Mrs. Teenform. Now you see, you can cry coast to coast. Oh, but you've stopped crying, haven't you, Mrs. Teenform? Thank you very much.
Mabel Hampton is 80 years old. She was a lesbian in Harlem in the 1930s, and Our Times' Renee McCoy talked to Mabel at the Lesbian Herstory Archives about love and survival and gay life in Harlem in the 1930s. Meet a fascinating person.
I'm Renee McCoy, and I'm here today at the Lesbian Herstory Archives interviewing Mabel Hampton, one of the finest black lesbians in our history, and certainly a pillar in our community and a strong positive role model for us all. Hi, Mabel, how are you?
I'm just fine, and you?
I'm all right.
Good.
I'm all right. I'm honored to be here with you. How old are you, Mabel?
I'm 80 years old.
Yeah? Yeah. How long have you been a lesbian?
I've been a lesbian mostly all my life.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
How'd you know that?
Well, I didn't love nobody but the girls, so I must have been a lesbian.
That's how you tell.
I can tell because I still love them.
Yeah? Yeah. Where are you from, Mabel?
Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
So how'd you end up in New York City?
Well, I came here when I was between 8 and 9. My grandmother died and my aunt brought me, came to Winston-Salem and got me and brought me to New York.
Yeah. What happened after you got to New York?
Well, I stayed with them for about just a year or so, and then I disappeared into thin air.
How old were you again?
I was around almost 10 years old, I think.
When you disappeared?
Well, I ran away.
And you never came back?
No, it was 14 years before I came back.
My goodness. What was the longest relationship you were ever in?
With a woman?
Yeah.
Well, I met one, and I met her in 1932 and stayed with her till she died in 1978.
46 years. How'd you meet her?
Well, that was an easy thing. I met her on Lexington Avenue and 23rd Street when the streetcars was running around then.
On the street?
Yeah, on the street. We both was waiting for the streetcar. See? And the streetcar pulled up. She says, "You getting on here?" I said, "Yeah, you?" "Yeah." So she says, "Okay." So she jumped up there. She was small. She jumped up there and pushed another woman aside. And, "Come on," she says. She grabbed my hand. I jumped up there. And we sat down. We began to talk. So I asked her her name. She said, "Lillian Foster." She asked me, "My name's Mabel Hampton." She said, "Where do you live?" I says, "In 122nd Street." She says, "Well, what are you doing out here?" I says, "I'm going downtown to look for a job." So she says, "Okay." So we talk and talk. She says, I said, "What are you doing now?" She says, "I'm going home." I said, "You come over and see me sometime?" She says, "Sure, I'd love to."
Did you know she was gay?
Sure, I knew it. I wasn't dumb.
Did she tell you that?
She didn't have to tell me. It's wrote all over her. And I know it was wrote over me. When you ask the whole lot of questions about people, you find out exactly what they are.
See? Yeah. Mabel, Why do you think that relationship lasted so long?
Well, one thing, we understood each other. And there's no use of anything being good if you don't make it good. We got along nicely. I wasn't jealous. She wasn't jealous. Of course, I had many different affairs, but that was under the cover.
She never found out?
No. How should? People I had them with wasn't going to tell her.
And you weren't going
to
tell
her? And I know good and well I wasn't going to tell them. So we got along nicely.
For 46 years, she never found out?
No, she never found out.
What do you think about gay liberation today?
Well, I like it very much, and I think if you keep at it, maybe in the next 20 years, you'll be all right.
Yeah.
But the thing is, you will have to deal with too many of these people who's locked in the closet and peeking out of the closet, see? Because they don't want you to come out to do anything at all.
When did you come out the closet?
Oh, I never was in there. You kidding me? I never was in no closet. I always was a free woman from the time, I think I was free from the time I was born.
Yeah. What was it like being a lesbian in Harlem?
Just the same as it was anywhere else, because I took over a part of Harlem, so it didn't bother me. I knew everybody, Jackie Mabry, Ethel Waters, all the women I knew. See, they didn't pay me any attention, I didn't pay them. I knew they was gay, and I imagined they knew I was.
Well, what happened to your friends? Do you still stay in touch with them?
Well, one of them is dead, and the other half is in the closet.
You try to get them to come out the closet?
No, they didn't want to come out. They got a hole in sanctimonious, and they think I'm crazy. And they got sense. And I think they're crazy, and I got sense.
What are the hopes that you have for the lesbian and gay community in the future?
Well, honest thing I can tell you what I hope for is they try and live right by each one of them. Each one tries to live good. Don't try to outdo anybody else. Try your best to be helpful to your gay community and give them a good advice and teach them that they don't have too much time because there's too many people against them. And the people against them are against themselves. They're not against them, they're against themselves.
Yeah. Thank you, Mabel.
You're quite welcome.
That was Mabel Hampton. Isn't she something? Next week on our show, we'll be talking about gay writers and gays in publishing. But right now, we have a letter from a rather disgruntled New Yorker. We thought you'd like to hear what this well-wisher has to say to us and you.
Yeah, this letter is dated February 25th, and it comes from Queens, New York, as if you couldn't figure that out. Dear sir, I deeply resent the new homo cable TV show to start on February 27th, 1983. The world is in bad enough without having this evil in our home. Needless to say, this is going to be stopped. It is a sick show for sick people, P-E-P-E-L, people who need people. And it's signed a disgusted mother. So just keep them coming, and needless to say, this show will not be stopped, especially not by people who refuse to sign their names to letters. And one more word about parents of gays. If your parents threaten to shoot themselves when you come out of the closet, why don't you do this? Why don't you offer to load the gun for them? I'll bet they don't do it. You know, they'll live, and you have a right to live, too. Don't forget that.
If you would like to write a letter to us, please send it to WNYC TV, Our Time, at 1 Center Street, New York, New York, 1007. This is Marcia Pally wishing you good night.
I wish we had a loaded gun.
Do you think that there's a good reason?
Parents?
Oh, I think there's a very good reason. I mean, consideration for a generation that isn't ready to accept it. And I didn't come out until both of my parents were dead. I think it's love. I mean, it's concern, and I think people have to come out when they're ready to come out, and that's the right way to do it. Mm-hmm.